The 1980s were a golden era for heavy metal, a time when the genre exploded onto the mainstream and became synonymous with the rebellious spirit of the decade. While many bands from this era produced extensive catalogs of hits, some became known for a select few anthems that have endured as defining tracks of the genre. These two hit wonders managed to capture the essence of 80s metal in just a couple of songs, leaving a lasting impact on the music scene. From the rebellious cries of Twisted Sister to the anthemic hooks of Quiet Riot, Ratt, Dokken, and Winger, these bands delivered powerful tracks that continue to resonate with fans decades later. So kick back and get your spandex on while we explore five of the most iconic two-hit wonders in heavy metal from the 80s, each with its own unique story and contributions to the genre that changed the landscape of music forever. All right, guys, let's get into our first iconic metal band in history. We've got Twisted Sister, of course, from New York City. They formed in about 1972 with a very strong glam rock undertow, but they quickly evolved into a heavy metal outfit with a strong glam metal image, to say the least. They were known for their outrageous costumes. If you've ever seen their videos or any of their posters, you would know this very quickly. But they became icons on the 1980s metal scene. They were big before they were even big. Before you knew Twisted Sister, they were outrageously huge in New York City, selling out tens of thousands of places of theaters. Now, Twisted Sister's legacy really was solidified with their anthemic songs that we're going to cover today. They had two ginormous hits that hit in 1984 on MTV, right? And that's what we're covering today. We're Not Gonna Take It from 1984, which reached number 21 on the Billboard Hot 100. How can anybody forget We're Not Gonna Take It if you were around during that time? It was one of the most hilarious videos on MTV at the time, and it was just like a new approach to the movie or video style. It was more like a movie. They used movie actors. They really just accentuated the potential of what an MTV music video could be, right? We're Not Gonna Take It also had a lot of folklore that surrounded it during this time. Now, the folklore wasn't always good, right? I mean, there was a lot of pushback on this song when it came back because it was so rebellious. We're Not Gonna Take It, the opening scenes were, you know, just really in your face that you're not down with the authorities that are in front of you trying to tell you what to do. And this really caught the attention of the Congress and things that were going on during that time. Specifically, what was going on during that time was censorship. Censorship of music. People wanted to try to really prohibit who could see music or listen to it even, or buy it, most importantly. So the Congress put together, or more importantly, Tipper Gore, a wife of a congressman, some of you might know, Al Gore. Well, Tipper Gore, she put together an agency called the Parents Music Resource Center. Go ahead and try to say that 20 times fast, which labeled any music that hit their list inappropriate for children, usually due to violent themes or sexual innuendo, whatever it might be. But, you know, Twisted Sister was really just having good old-fashioned fun and a little slapstick, you know, entertainment to kind of scare the parents, and, well, I guess it worked, right? Because Twisted Sister's frontman, Dee Snider, found himself in front of Congress in 1985 defending his songs and arguing for heavy metal. Thank you, Dee. We appreciate that. But this incident cemented the song's place in rock history as a battle cry against censorship. So We're Not Gonna Take It had to make our list, A, for one, since it was a hit song hitting number 21, and B, for two, it really shook up the place, right? But, you know, there was other controversy surrounding this, right? When he went to Congress, he made the Filthy 15. That was part of their big list out there, right? So Tipper Gore, they put together this list, they put these artists on there, and they called it the Filthy 15. It was like Motley Crue and Slayer. There was all the cool bands of the time, basically, were on it. And the funny thing about it is, it just boosted everybody's music sales, right? Because why? Everybody got a really cool censorship sticker. And who doesn't want a cool censorship sticker on your heavy metal album? Hell yeah, that's what you want, right? So all these metal bands were really silently embracing it. Meanwhile, they had to go on TV and say, this is wrong, please sell our albums, buy them, you shouldn't, no, don't listen to them. It was horrible, right, for the parents. They were just like up in arms. But in the end, I think metal won, right? But, you know, besides We're Not Gonna Take It, Twisted Sister's other anthem, and these are both really anthems because everybody in a crowd, when these songs come out, it's hard to find somebody in the room that's not singing along, not rocking out to it. Even grandmas and grandpas in the room would probably do it, right? Our second iconic anthem from Twisted Sister, of course, was 1984's I Wanna Rock, which reached number 68 on the Billboard Hot 100. And just like We're Not Gonna Take It, there was folklore surrounding this song, 100%. We're Not Gonna Take It really became an anthem of defiance. And this second song, I Wanna Rock, was really no different. The music video featuring a strict teacher being transformed into a helpless figure by the power of rock music played into the theme of rock as a liberating force against authority. It also became a staple in many 80s teen movies, further embedding its rebellious spirit into the pop culture. You know, but there was a little bit of controversy too. Just like We're Not Going to Take It, I Want to Rock was criticized for its perceived encouragement of rebellious behavior. Hell yeah. What do you think it was supposed to encourage? It was a rebellious song, you know, but it was always in fun. There was no violence. I take that back. The video had a little bit of comedic violence in it, right? But it was more like the Three Stooges, you know? But it was a hilarious video, and that's what made it so popular out the gate. And also their image was very iconic at the time, really resonated with people in this music scene, and really stepped it up a notch. You know, Kiss was the only other band before Twisted Sister that was really going to this extent and extreme with makeup and theatrics and just their outfits and costumes. So, you know, the controversy around Twisted Sister wasn't just with their themes and their songs. It was also around their appearance in general. So Twisted Sister's journey from glam rock band in 1972 to heavy metal icons in the 1980s was marked by their bold image and anthemic rebellious songs. Their hits We're Not Gonna Take It and I Wanna Rock became defining tracks of the era, celebrated for their defiance and widely popularized by MTV. Both songs stirred controversy, particularly with the parents, Music Resource Center, and they saw them as promoting violence and rebellion. However, Dee Snider's defense of the band's music before Congress solidified these tracks as symbols of fighting censorship, further embedding Twisted Sister's legacy in rock history, making them a hard rock and heavy metal icon.
We're on to our second band in our two-hit wonder of heavy metal episode, and it's a good one. It's Quiet Riot. Quiet Riot was formed in Los Angeles in 1973 by Randy Rhoads, of all people. But the band is really known for Kevin DuBrow and their hit song, Come On Feel the Noise, in 1983. It hit number 5 in the Billboard charts. It was not popular with the band. They hated the idea. But not only did it hit number 5, Come On Feel the Noise, and the record it was on, Metal Health, hit number 1. All because it was insisted by the producer that they cover this song by a band from the 70s called Slade. And they didn't like the idea, so the drummer just kind of looked at Kevin. They're just like, let's do it. And Kevin's just like, well, I guess I could sing it badly. And they all agreed, yes, you can sing it badly. So that's exactly what he did. And it's a good thing he did, because Come On Feel the Noise hit number 1, put the band on the map, put the genre on the map, put hair metal on the map, and really just blew open the doors and made it very successful. Controversy was, of course, part of what they did. The spelling of the song, you know, Come On Feel the Noise, was pretty straightforward. But to give it a youthful edge, put them on the map, they spelled it C-U-M. Obviously, at the time, in the 80s, oh, it put them on the map. It gave them a sticker, PMRC. It helped sell the record. They were a hit on MTV. And overall, it's funny how controversy can really, you know, one slight thing can put you over the edge, and all of a sudden you're a household name. So they were tremendously successful on that, and they had another hit. They had another hit called Metal Health, Bang Your Head. Banging your head became a ritual when this came out. It formed a new subculture of what you did. You went to a hair metal concert, didn't matter who you saw. It could be Ratt, it could be even Winger. It could be Motley Crue, Ozzy Osbourne, but in this case, we're talking about Quiet Riot, and you banged your head. And you would get head, neck injuries. But it was a ritual. You'd go in and you would just rock out. And that was the whole point of the whole ritual. And so here we have Quiet Riot that most of the members, unfortunately, had passed away at this point, but they're still out there. They're still touring. You could still find them. And people still know their songs. So they're still valid, and bless them for being there. Bless them for being out there still. They put us on the map and gave us something to talk about and gave you something to watch. Bang Your Head, Come On Feel the Noise. Again, controversy. The controversy with Bang Your Head, it was an aggressive title. It was linked to, again, injuries. And the act of banging your head was frowned upon by the Tipper Gores of the world, and the parents didn't like what they were doing. And later, you know, kids actually began moshing and did other things in concerts that were actually even more prone to injuries. But right now, we gotta thank Quiet Riot for what they did. And those two songs, had it not been for those two songs, we wouldn't have a lot of bands to talk about today. So, being formed in Los Angeles in 1973, pioneering the whole genre with an energetic hair metal style, and really, really killing it on the Billboard charts, their contributions were undeniable. And their stage presence left a lasting mark on everything that was done in the era and the challenges they faced.
All right, we're on to our number three iconic metal band. These bands, they created anthems from the 80s that just changed the music landscape forever, especially hard rock and heavy metal, more importantly, glam metal, to be specific. But, you know, this band could not be overlooked because they really kind of took the 80s by storm. Nobody had ever heard of them before. They came out of San Diego in 1977, and of course I'm talking about the band Ratt. They moved to Los Angeles. They pulled in an 18-year-old guitar player by the name of Warren D. Martini and said, get down here right away, or up here rather, and let's get this band happening because we need you. You are one of the guys that's going to make this band the best it can be, because they had some of the catchiest hooks of the time, some of the best melodies, and they had a dual guitar attack that really was only heard before by like the likes of Judas Priest and the Scorpions. So when Ratt came on the scene, they had kind of like this new style to them, but they had the really cool 80s LA glam metal scene down to a pat, and they were basically sex symbols for the ladies and the gentlemen. They were freaking hard rock freaking icons already, because they were, well, they were getting the ladies, but they were getting all the cool songs out. You know, Ratt gained the most popularity though in the mid 80s from their Out of the Cellar album. That album basically just blew up overnight, and it had a lot to do with their rat and roll style, as they used to call it, and especially their hit single Round and Round from 1984 again. And this one reached number 12 on the Billboard Hot 100, so it was solidified a really big hit. You know, this album did extremely well as well out there. But in 1984, Round and Round was widely regarded as the song to beat in the metal world, because it just hit every note perfectly. It was a hard rock cool riff. It was a heavy metal anthem. It had dual guitar stuff. It had a crazy funky video. You know, some of the folklore about it was that Milton Berle was in the video, right? Milton Berle, for people that are not even our age, older usually, would know who Milton Berle is. Milton Berle was a really huge comedian from the Hollywood eras, the classic Hollywood eras, you know, and for him to be in a metal video, that was just unheard of, right? And he did a couple of sticks in it that were pretty classic and quite hilarious, you know. He was dressed in drag, for one, and, you know, he was a comedian and legend, and his image on the video just elevated their music in the video to this other level. It was like, how in the first place could you even get this guy to make a cameo? But that had to do with the Milton Berle being the band manager's nephew. So that's how that folklore came to be, and it really, I'd say, helped out what Ratt was doing at that time. There was also some controversy surrounding Round and Round at the time, because, you know, it really kind of gave this superficial, hedonistic view of what metal was about. And, you know, that's kind of what it was about in the 80s. It was pretty hedonistic. It was on the edge. They were partying. They were doing a lot of crazy stuff out there that I wouldn't say you kids should do. But I'm just letting you know what they were doing at the time, and that's what they got a lot of heat for. The critics said that they shouldn't, you know, you shouldn't back this band because they're just going to turn your kids into, you know, criminals. But, you know, I turned out all right. Maybe not. I don't know. But that's how Round and Round got on the scene again, hitting number 12. One of the, you know, one-hit wonders there, right? But if they were just a one-hit wonder, they wouldn't have had Lay It Down hit. And in 1985, the next year on their next album, Lay It Down reached number 40 on the Billboard Hot 100. That was pretty iconic for them to have a back-to-back success like this. Their first album was already hugely successful. And in many ways, Invasion of Your Privacy, their second album, didn't hit that same mark. But it was still a success because anything that goes multi-platinum after its first go is something that is to be known for, you know? And so, you know, what's some of the folklore surrounding this? Well, some of the folklore was just the humor of this song, right? That Lay It Down, this video, it was basically a kid's birthday party and this heavy metal band shows up, you know, and it really was just an iconic video because it was like what, I mean, I would have loved for Ratt to play my birthday in 1985. Are you kidding me? I was like 10 years old. That would have been epic. And it would have turned out exactly like the Ratt video. And that would have been really cool. But that laid some controversy, you know. They got still in this crossfire of like, really, a heavy metal band at a 10-year-old's birthday party? That's really not good for, you know, the parental units to see. That's something that they really shouldn't be thinking about. And it's just promoting the excess of the 80s, the rock star lifestyle, the promiscuity, all this stuff. And that's where the controversy really came in. But, you know, otherwise, Lay It Down was really not that controversial when you think about it. But, you know, again, it kind of gave this rebellious edge to the music video. It was humorous. It was comedic. I think what you find with a lot of these videos where the congresses of the world, the parents of the world will turn it into some, you know, conspiracy. The bands were really just having fun and just kind of, you know, making a mockery out of what they knew the watchdogs would say. So that's what happened with Ratt. You know, Ratt put out these two amazing albums and had two back-to-back amazing hits. So that's why they made the two-hit wonder for us. But Ratt's journey from formation in 1977 to becoming a staple of the glam metal scene is a testament to their unique blend of catchy hooks and heavy riffs, their dual guitar attack of Warren DeMartini and Robin Crosby. Their successes like Round and Round, Lay It Down, just gave them a very unique sound, which was, again, notably called the Ratt and Roll style, right? A lot of people would just refer to it as Ratt and Roll instead of rock and roll, but it was still glam metal at the time. And Ratt's influence on the glam metal scene was undeniable. They were hanging out with the guys from Motley Crue and all these guys in that LA music scene there, and they really just... They were definitely a band to look up to at the time and set the mark very high for any metal band to come out after that.
Here we are with band number 4 on our two-hit wonder episode of Heavy Metal, and we're rocking with Dokken. Dokken formed in 1979 in Los Angeles. They were more of a melodic approach to heavy metal. Although they have very heavy songs, they had a very melodic tone to what they did. They had great records, particularly two of them, To the Nail and Under Lock and Key. They had a great guitar player. His name was George Lynch. Phenomenal. He was known in Guitar Magazine and he was a virtuoso of sorts. But there were internal tensions in the band due to the fact that they were really trying to do a heavier sound and wound up with power ballads. Power ballads wound up taking over the whole genre, but that's in the future. But they kind of broke the mold here. And the first song, Alone Again, reached number 64 on the Billboard charts. Alone Again is quintessential to the 80s. But again, it was referred to as a power ballad, and they were kind of scratching their heads on that, but yet the crowds and the people and their fans, they ate it up. And it didn't nearly make it, they nearly didn't put it on the record of Tooth and Nail, but again, it's a good thing they did, or else they might not have done anything with that record. The second hit for Dokken was In My Dreams. In My Dreams reached number 77 on the Billboard charts. Again, a pretty song. Don Dokken had a pretty voice, and it was a melodic song, heavier and it was played as an encore on their tours because it became such a hit. And again, it's a good thing they put it on the record. The crowd ate it up, their fans ate it up, and the controversy behind it, it was kind of, to the fans, was it a true heavy metal song? Was it a ballad? Was it a pop song? They couldn't figure it out, but it didn't matter because it was a hit. And George Lynch can't be understated in what he did. He put the metal in the melodic efforts of Dokken, which really made the band and put the sounds in the metal category, if you will. It strayed from the typical raunchy, bang your head type music that they did in the 80s, but again, broke the mold. Now everybody's doing power ballads. Now everybody's hitting the charts, and now everybody, more importantly, is making money. Dokken still is out there to this day, and thank the Lord, Don Dokken, George Lynch, they're still with us. They never really got along, but they get along because they have a great band. And if you look around, there you can find them on tour, whether they're on a solo tour, whether they're doing stuff together. But if you do get a chance to check them out, go bang your head and listen to a Dokken song and know that they contributed to our two-hit wonders.
All right, guys, for our final band, we're heading for 1987. This marks the latest period in the 80s that we're covering a band with these two hits that really changed the music landscape forever. You know, this band, they were formed in New York City, and they were formed by bassist and singer Kip Winger. If you haven't figured it out yet, yes, I'm talking about the band Winger. This band was known for their blend of heavy metal with a little bit more polished sound, very radio friendly, but it also had a little bit of progressive edge to it, thanks in part by their guitar player, Reb Beach, who was extremely talented. Two-tapping wonder, definitely in the likes of Van Halen and what have you. But most importantly, with Kip Winger involved, they created some great songs. And these songs became anthems and hits in their own right, right? But, you know, Winger really had their breakout successes through MTV, which will later be their main downfall, but we'll get into that in a bit. But songs like 17 and Headed for Heartbreak received tremendous airplay on MTV at the time, despite some criticism on the elements and themes of these songs, such as 17. But lucky for them, their musicianship and melodic sensibilities saved them from controversy, for the most part. But let's talk about these songs. So in 1988, by far their most controversial song, but by far their most popular song, 17, hit the landscape, right? And it reached number 26 on the Billboard Hot 100. Now, again, there is some controversy and folklore surrounding this song. But, you know, 17's controversial lyrics were really what made that happen, you know? It was a different era that they were singing about, you know? It was the late 80s. But don't be fooled by this. You know, the late 80s, there was already a ton of songs out there that have covered this topic, and it's a little slapstick, but you had things like Christine 16 from Kiss. You had the Beatles singing, you know, about these songs. And it was, you know, they were young men singing about their peers. So at the time, though, Kip Winger wasn't exactly a young man. He was singing about a 17-year-old girl. That's a little suspect, but we won't totally knock him for it because we don't know what state he lived in. Anyhow, Kip Winger was a frontman. He was, you know, another controversy or folklore surrounding him was that he was a former ballerina. So maybe that's where the inspiration of 17 came from. I don't really know. But again, 17, that controversy really stuck out when you heard lyrics like, she's only 17, daddy says she's too young, but she's old enough for me. Hey now, I'm not here to judge, I'm just here to tell you the story of 17, and that was what the controversy was all about there, you know? But it was still a hit song, you know? It's been criticized, but I think everybody who knows the band, the songwriters involved with it, they know that this is just a slapstick theme, you know? It's been used many times in many formats, whether it's movies or music, you know? So 17, nonetheless, was one of Winger's biggest songs. It wasn't certainly an anthem, and I was wrong. It's not actually their biggest song. Why? Because Headed for Heartbreak in 1989, that actually reached number 19 on the Billboard Hot 100. Now, there was some folklore around it. It showcased Winger's more serious, melodic side. It was certainly, you know, a power ballad. So this really changed up the mood for Winger. Before, their songs were a little more rocking, a little more energy, a little more upbeat and up-tempo. But, you know, unfortunately for them, in the 1990s, Beavis and Butthead got a hold of it. And that really kind of ended Winger's run. I mean, there's no way else to say it, really. The song got in front of Beavis and Butthead, and Beavis and Butthead did what they do. And it was awesome. It was hilarious. But if you were Winger, it meant that was the end of your career for that time span. He's doing very well now, but at that time, I'll tell you right now, that controversy from Beavis and Butthead really just kind of, it sent Winger into a downward spiral. It's quite unfortunate because they had a very strong run, very strong musicians in the band. But again, the controversy for Headed for Heartbreak was too much to overcome, especially with the transition from kind of the hair metal, glam metal thing to grunge that was about to take place. Like, this was like, these were all the final nails. Many people cite, grunge as being the definitive final nail in glam metal and that hair metal scene, but I'd have to say MTV and Beavis and Butthead really kind of helped out in this by far, because, you know, you got Beavis and Butthead wearing AC/DC and Metallica shirts, and then the nerd of the bunch, Stuart, is wearing a Winger shirt all the time. And then they feature that song one day on Beavis and Butthead, and they do a comedy shtick on it, and I'm sorry to say, it really just tanked Winger out. Their tours started to decline, their album sales started to decline, and it just marked the new era. And again, grunge was about to hit, so that was going to do the final nail job on hair metal and everything else. But for Winger, I'd have to say Beavis and Butthead, they can thank single-handedly for this, you know? But again, you know, Winger, they always brought a more polished, radio-friendly sound and twist to heavy metal that really stood out. And honestly, I'd say it brought probably more a more diverse crowd to a Winger show. You'd probably see more ladies and gentlemen at the Winger show, because I'd say Kip Winger was a ballerina freaking sex icon to these ladies. And he'd twirl around on stage, and that's what the ladies were there to see. And Red Beach would do a killer guitar solo, and that's what the guys were there to see. Everyone was winning. But unfortunately, when Beavis and Butthead hit the scene, Winger lost hard. And that was the end of Winger, really. Until now. Nowadays, Kip Winger's still out there. He does a great job. He's a great songwriter, great composer, still writing music to this day. And, you know, for many people, it's sad that that's their legacy, that Beavis and Butthead kind of took them out. But I'd say that their story's never over. You know, Kip Winger continues to move on and rock out there across the United States. So you'll see him out there still. But we just wanted to dedicate, this moment to Winger, because they are certainly one of the only glam metal bands of this era that was able to achieve a two-hit wonder status. And we appreciate that. And we thank Winger for putting those songs out and giving us some entertainment during those years. I'm going to pass this out now. We're heading on home. Get back to Ed. Thanks, guys.
The legacy of the 1980s heavy metal scene was rich with anthems that defined a generation, and the two-hit wonders. The era played a significant role in shaping the sound and attitude of the genre. Twisted Sister, Quiet Riot, Ratt, Dokken, Winger may have only just had a couple of hits. These songs became an example of the spirit capturing the rebellion, energy, and melodic power that made the 80s so unforgettable. These tracks not only brought heavy metal to a broader audience and solidified these bands in their place in rock history, even as trends in music had shifted throughout the years and fans alike, the enduring appeal of these two-hit wonders serves as a testament of the power of well-crafted songwriting and the long-lasting influence of 1980s heavy metal and the heavy metal scene. Moving right along, I just want to remind you to subscribe and like our channel. We love your comments. Give us some comments. We love the feedback. So we're going to keep it running. Just remember, subscribe, like, thanks a lot. We want to give a shout out to coastlinemall.com. They sell t-shirts, they sell 80s t-shirts, they sell 80s rock and metal t-shirts, they sell movie t-shirts, and most importantly, they support us and we support them. So with the coupon code CRASH, you get buy one, get one half off. Please give them a visit, buy a t-shirt, give a friend a t-shirt, tune in. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.